30 years before Austin Powers. It showed us how to wear flares and tank tops, how to ignore world events, and most importantly, how to say groovy. The show was, of course, The Brady Bunch, the most wholesome and clean-cut family ever to emerge from television land. Or were they? Hello, I'm Melissa Jane Cook, and tonight we're putting the Bradys under the microscope. So if you'd like those memories to remain pure and sweet, switch off now, because I'm going to reveal much more about the Bradys than you ever wanted to know.
Here's the story of a lovely lady who was bringing up three very lovely girls. All of them had hair of gold, like their mother, the youngest one in curls. It's the story of a man named Brady, who was busy with three boys of his own. They were four men living all together, yet they were all alone. Till the one day when the lady met this fellow, and they knew that it was much more than a hunch, that this group must somehow form a family. That's the way they all became the Brady Bunch.
The Brady Bunch. The Brady Bunch. That's the way.
It sounds simple enough, but the Bradys were the first blended family ever to be shown on TV. Somehow they hit a chord which kept them rolling as a sitcom, variety show, and even a drama for three decades. It all began with a marriage, and even though Mike and Carol had done it before, they were as nervous as first-timers.
I once saw a movie where a man was getting married. He was so nervous he forgot to put his pants on. You're okay, Dad.
Thanks a lot. Would you sit down?
I'm sure you're going to be very happy. Mrs. Martin is a lovely woman.
She's out of sight, Dad. Groovy. I think she's neato.
Well, that makes it unanimous. I think she's pretty special myself.
Well, I certainly hope the bride isn't as nervous as the groom.
How can you girls sit there and say that I look beautiful?
Because we love you.
Girls. Oh, you do like Mike, don't you?
Sure we like him.
A lot.
You know how much we like him?
How much?
This much.
I'm sure we're all going to be very happy. You're going to be happy. I'm going to be happy. Mike's going to be happy. And Greg and Peter and Bobby, they're going to be happy.
If we're all going to be so happy, how come your eyes look like they're going to cry?
Because grown-ups are silly. Sometimes they cry when they're happy.
Maybe Carol was crying because she had the feeling everything was going to go horribly wrong. It all seemed so squeaky clean, but the facts prove otherwise. Behind the scenes, the Brady Bunch was a seething pit of unwholesome sexuality. It's no secret the Brady dad, Robert Reed, was gay. What may surprise is the extent to which this threatened to tear the show apart.
I sympathize with him, because here he is, the father of America, and he can't come out of the closet.
I just wanted to thank you for your advice.
Then there's attraction between brothers and sisters.
It's no secret that she developed into quite an attractive young lady. And I think given all that history there, it was only natural that there was some overlay. Keep in mind, too, we were teenagers. And teenagers have a certain enthusiasm or hormonal charge that that kicks in. And it's fair to say that it did. Throughout most of the filming.
Eve Plum's fascination with her on-screen brother, Christopher Knight.
I had a big crush on him. And like my mother said, well, it's proximity, dear, you know. I wasn't around any other boys. I was around him, you know, 90% of the time, and he was the one that was closest in age. So I think that it was probably perfectly natural for me to have a crush on him.
Come on, Jen.
Where? Why don't we break a record, too? We can't let two little kids beat us out.
Eve had a romantic interest, I guess, in me for a long time. And but she has a lot of patience. And finally, near the end, I finally, you know, woke up. and saw that there's this beautiful girl here and she's interested in me.
Even tiny Cindy and her less than G-rated feelings towards her brother, Bobby.
Well, he was kind of aggressive. He'd come up behind me and hug me, and, you know, it's all so innocent. I mean, we didn't know how to make out. We just, I love you, I love you. And he was the first little boy that would, you know, grab me and kiss me, and I thought, that's okay. You know, I don't mind that. Of course, it didn't last long because Michael's eye wandered and Eve was developing. I wasn't, so I lost him.
Oh, Greg, haven't we been through all that?
And perhaps the most alarming sexual attraction of all, between Greg Brady and his mother.
I had an infatuation with Florence the whole time we were filming the show, and there was always some innocent flirtation going back and forth. Most importantly, she didn't treat me like a kid, and I really respected that. She has a great sense of humor, and I was very responsive to that.
People would just love to think that, you know, there was incest on the Brady Bunch. They'd love that.
All these pressures had to take their toll, and life after the Bradys was never easy. Brady mum Florence Henderson developed a fear of performing and was forced to undergo hypnotherapy.
What I'm going to do is ask you to open your eyes, and I want you to look directly at me. Now. Okay, that's fine.
Actor Ann B. Davis, who played Alice the maid,
Alice, those cookies smell delicious,
has since joined a religious community and will never act again.
I really don't care to perform on stage or off anymore. I've really done that. I'm very happy and content with my life, the people that I share my life with, and the place that I've come to live. And I'd just rather not do that anymore. And if God is good, he'll let me retire.
And in 1997, Mike Luckenland, who played adorable little Bobby, was arrested and now shuns all media contact. But the greatest Brady tragedy was the death in 1992 of actor Robert Reed from an AIDS-related illness.
What was appealing about the Brady Bunch was it was a child's fantasy of what a family was like. I mean, you know, I was from like a broken family. I loathed my brothers and sisters, basically. Dad was always busy. We had a very unpleasant dog. And here was a family who they loved each other. They supported each other. The parents listened to each other. They were kind. They were
that's
good.
I think that was a reference point to compare your own family to.
Part of you wanted to believe that you wished your family could be like the Bradys as well. And I think it's this, that kind of dual feeling, the love for them, and also simultaneously thinking they're just daggy, hopeless geeks. That those two things mixed together is a very Australian emotion. It's something that we feel a lot about our favourite cultural icons.
I think they'd have been better off making a show about what went on off-screen rather than on. Hang on a moment, I think they already have. It's Melrose Place, isn't it?
The Brady Bunch pilot was shot in September of 1968. In the episode, widower Mike Brady and divorcee Carol Martin get married and then decide to take their six kids on the honeymoon. Things didn't run too smoothly. The biggest problem, naturally enough, was the lack of sexual chemistry between the newlyweds, Mike and Carol Brady.
It was a scene where we were supposed to be, you know, very lovey-dovey and kissing, and we'd rehearsed it and it was fine. And then when we got ready to shoot it, Bob started complaining about something, and all of a sudden that was the moment that I knew that Bob was very nervous about the love scene.
Well, how do I look?
You, my dear, are prettier than flowers, sweeter than the cake, more appetizing than the hors d'oeuvres, and more sparkling than the silverware.
Oh, Mike, be serious.
You want to know something?
Yes.
I am serious.
A few years ago, I thought it was the end of the world.
Now it's just the beginning. For both of us.
For all of us.
Right. The whole blooming Brady Bunch.
She came over to me and she said to me, "How well do you know this guy?" I said, "I don't know. He did a good test with you and he's Mr. Brady." I said, "Why?" And she said, "He ain't straight." I said, "What do you mean he ain't straight?"
I said, "I really think you should back off, because I think Bob's gay, and he's having a problem with this scene." I said, "Let me handle it." And they did, and we got the scene, and that's the way it was from then on.
You, Carol Ann,
Take this man to be your lawful wedded husband, to have and to hold, to honor and obey, to love and cherish, in sickness and in health, till death do you part.
I do.
Do you, Michael Paul, take this woman to be your lawful wedded wife, to have and to hold, to honor and obey, to love and cherish, till death do you part?
I do.
I now pronounce you man and wife. They whom God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. Well, aren't you going to kiss the bride?
You bet I am.
Reed never discussed his sexuality with anyone connected to the show. Not even his strongest supporter, Paramount Vice President Douglas S. Kramer.
I think it was something everybody was a little nervous about, because in the 60s, even today, I mean, putting a family show on with a gay father is something, as an actor, you don't know what could happen in terms of the press, I think, would give advertisers and networks a certain degree of nervousness.
I was aware that he had a different lifestyle, but that wasn't something that he brought into the set, and it wasn't something that he brought into the relationship. It wasn't something that he brought into his professional world.
Reed's personal lifestyle didn't seem like it was going to be a problem, because no one at the studio expected the Brady Bunch to make it as a series.
The general feeling was that we hadn't quite caught it, that there was a flatness to it, and while some of the cast was terrific, that it was never going to work, that it was a little dated and a little old-fashioned. It played a little 50-ish in terms of Leave It to Beaver time.
I couldn't help screaming, and neither could Marcia and Jam. But Mama yelled at us anyway. She didn't even yell at the boys, and it was their dog that chased Fluffy. Maybe she likes him better than us.
I feel funny about Cindy. And Marcia and Jan, too. I shouldn't have scolded them at the wedding.
I shouldn't have yelled at the boys.
7 months after the pilot was shot, however, the American ABC network was coming last in the ratings and desperately needed a hit show. Executives decided to try the Brady Bunch over the autumn and ordered 13 new episodes. Filming began on the Paramount backlot in the summer of 1969. Meanwhile, Sherwood Schwartz put the finishing touches in the show's signature opening.
I believe that close-ups are what television is all about. How do you get 9 close-ups? So I was just in my office doodling around, and I came up with this checkerboard.
That's the way they became the Brady Bunch.
Nice idea, Sherwood. The checkerboard was unveiled when the Brady Bunch made its network debut on Friday, September 26, 1969. But the results were lousy, with mediocre ratings and a dismal review.
We got a lousy, lousy review of our pilot that said, and as the 6 children troop up the stairs to follow their parents on their honeymoon, we hope that they never come down again.
One way to handle it. Attention! Okay, fall in. Right here. According to size, and big ones first. Come on, fast. In the ranks back there, come on. No talking in the ranks. Come on, hurry up, hurry up. Okay. Left foot first. Forward! Heart! 2, 3.
Good night, Mr. Gringo.
2, 3, 4. Left, left, right, left. Left, 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 right, left, left.
It got to be funny after a while. I mean, everything was really bad with, like, the Brady Bunch. And you think, oh, come on, come off it. It's not that bad, for pity's sake.
The criticism didn't worry Schwartz. He'd had plenty of bad reviews for Gilligan's Island, and that show was a huge hit. Sherwood Schwartz stuck to his guns. He wanted the Bradys to be a family which dealt with everyday problems. Everyday problems which never included sex or violence.
It's a show without explosions, it's a show without drugs, it's a show without rapes, it's a show about nice, decent, normal.
You really had to accept his philosophy and then try to tweak it wherever you could and find ways of having it not be so molasses and cotton candy.
No Brady ever used a swear word. Carol never discussed her previous partner. Mike wouldn't think of hitting the kids. And they hardly ever mentioned they were part of a blended family.
Nobody said goodbye to me or anything. And I didn't think anybody cared.
Oh, sweetheart, everybody cares. And I'll bet you your baseball card, you can't guess who cares the most.
You? Even though I'm only a step?
Listen, the only steps in this house are those. The ones that lead up to your bedroom. So how about marching right back up there?
Hey, Dad! Mom and me are back home again.
Good. Because that's where you both belong.
When we come back, teenage hormones take their toll on the Brady kids.
It's not easy being a woman.
I loved the Bradys. I remember rushing home from school and grabbing a glass of Tang and plumping myself down in front of the telly. Cindy was my favorite, and I even used to do my hair like her. I had a bit of a crush on Peter. More than anything, though, I wanted to be a Brady, and I can tell you, I wasn't the only one.
Well, my favorite character in the Brady Bunch was Greg, because we always wanted to be like Greg. We thought he was pretty cool. He had the paisley shirts. I remember when he was going to be the singer with the family, and I was right into singing at the time. And he was going to be like, I think it was Johnny Bravo or something, and he had the leather strips hanging off the jacket, and I thought, I want to be Johnny Bravo, you know, this is great.
I've got to say Marsha, because I always looked up to her. She was like the cool older sister thing, you know, she had the hair going, had the boys down pat, she had the fashion, you know, the really, really hip fashion. Tragic now when you look at it.
Jan, always Jan. Why? I think it's obvious. Like me, she was the difficult one. Misunderstood, artistic, sensitive. Fabulous.
Definitely Marsha, because she was everything personified that you wanted to be. She was the best at everything. She was the best public speaker. She was the cheerleader. She was good at sport. She was smart. She was pretty. She was everything that, you know, most of us really aren't. So you sort of looked up to her.
I used to get letters almost always from girls in their teens, 12 years to 15 years around there, saying, I'm leaving home. I'm coming out to Hollywood to become part of the Brady Bunch.
Hi, girls.
Morning, Doug.
Oh, Marsha, I've been looking for you.
Me?
Yeah. I was wondering if you'd like to go to a dance with me on Saturday night.
Yeah, I'd love to.
Oh, great. Saturday night, then, okay?
Bye.
I'll see you.
Bye. Date with Doug Simpson? Can I touch you? Might rub off.
The Brady Bunch wasn't exactly a smash hit in its first season in America in 1969 and 1970. It rated around the middle of the pack. Even the sitcom's creator worried about the fate of the series.
We were not an immediate success. The show was okay, but that's all it was. And then there was a question about a pickup for a second year. In fact, I was in Africa, in Nairobi, when I got a telegram saying congratulations were picked up, because there was doubt.
Adult viewers hated the show, but kids loved it. The American ABC network decided to target a younger audience on Friday nights. So in the autumn of 1970, Fridays kicked off with the Brady Bunch, followed by Nanny and the Professor, The Partridge Family, That Girl, and Love American Style. In its second season, the Brady Bunch remained dedicated to solving kids' everyday problems in 30 minutes or less, and always with a happy ending.
Isn't it nice to have a life that any problem you have is going to get solved in 23 and a half minutes?
My daughter, when having turned 14, asked me one time when I came home, says, why aren't you like that at home? And I said, you don't give me a 28-minute problem.
You set it up and you write it out and you solve the problem and everybody ends up living happily ever after, unless you have a two-parter, and then you've got to leave a little hook at the end for that.
The Brady Bunch was also one of the first television shows to portray a husband and wife in a romantic relationship. Episodes often ended with Mike and Carol Brady kissing each other goodnight. Those scenes were particularly difficult for Robert Reed.
It was interesting when we'd have a love scene. It would usually be at the end of the day. because they would save those scenes for when the kids, you know, had to leave and all. And sometimes I would see Bob's heart actually beating through his pajamas. And, you know, I had a lot of compassion.
Hey, can I get a good night kiss?
You didn't say anything about a good night kiss.
Hmm?
No. You just said you had to get some sleep. Those were your exact words.
Oh, no, but that's not what I meant.
Oh, well, go ahead.
On the other hand, those weren't my exact words.
Oh, now, Mike, come on. Come on. Give me a kiss.
I'll give you a kiss.
I sympathize with him because here he is, the father of America, and he can't come out of the closet.
You know, Bob Reed never flaunted his sexuality. He was what he was, and my concern was that he was a nice human being for the most part on the set. He was a good friend, and he was a great actor.
Even though Robert Reed always hated the character of Mike Brady, he developed close relationships with his co-stars off camera. Although he was married briefly in the 1950s and had a daughter named Karen, Reed treated the Brady kids as if they were his own. He showered them with gifts and once even took them on a cruise to England.
I always felt like there was a hole in Bob's heart because he didn't have his little girl, and that I think sometimes all the love that he had for Karen went to us kids.
Despite whatever problems he was having on the outside of the set, he was always very committed to our cast and to the kids in particular, and we had a great, great fondness.
In real life, when a lot of TV dads at the time, and I won't name names, were not the greatest of men and were certainly dreadful to their co-stars and to the children on their shows, Robert Reed was a man who had tremendous affection for the children, always looked out for them, and in fact, they were very much the reason he kept re-signing with the show. He battled for 5 long years about scripts and about the shallowness of the program. And at the end of the day, what kept him coming back was this tremendous affection he had for the 6 kids that were playing his children. He saw himself very much as a patriarch of the cast. He looked after everybody in quite a sweet sort of way.
Off-camera relationships also developed between the kids.
Marsha, I can't keep up with you.
Me either. It's not easy being a woman.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. It's a lot easier for you than it is for me.
The adolescent hormones occasionally created problems. Producer Lloyd Schwartz took over directing duties for one episode in which Barry had trouble hiding his feelings for Maureen.
And I realized that this was becoming romantic. See, the young guy, the young girl on the bed, this is romantic. They are brother and sister. It's not supposed to be romantic. And I go, what am I going to do? And this was not in any book I'd read about directing. What if the brother and sister are hot for each other? And I finally took Barry aside and I said, Barry, now look, Maureen is a very pretty girl, and we both understand that. But what's much better for you, instead of going around after her, because this could be a problem for all of us, she's got pretty friends. Just use her to get to the friends. And Barry bought this.
Well, don't worry, she's just having a good time. Sweetheart, did you and Charlie have a good time?
Oh, yeah. The movie was great. Charlie's really super.
Sounds like you had fun.
Mm-hmm. Guess who we ran into later at the pizza place?
Don't tell me, Doug Sampson.
Big man on campus?
Yep.
Was it uncomfortable?
It may have been uncomfortable at first, but by 1972, the Bradys were taking off around the world. Marketing executives smelled money, and they went into a feeding frenzy. Brady Bunch merchandising blossomed overnight. Personally, I couldn't resist the Sydney lunchbox. It was my proudest possession. I wonder what you had. The viewers' love affair with the cast created a marketing boom for the Brady Bunch. By the sitcom's 3rd season in 1972, there were colouring books, paper dolls, games, and lunchboxes featuring the show's characters. That same year also saw the premiere of a Saturday morning cartoon called The Brady Kids. And when Barry Williams and some of the other cast members showed an interest in music, yet another business venture was explored.
We had the Osmond Brothers and the Jackson Five and the DeFranco family, and there were probably a couple of other groups that were out and about and making records. Oh, the Partridge Family. And that looked good. It sure looked good to me.
It looked good enough to the show's producers, too. So the Brady Bunch Kids musical group made their debut during an episode in the third season in 1972.
What kids? Yours! His! Ours! Come on, quick!
You said they went to a football game.
That's what I said. They said...
Check out the way Alice keeps cleaning the furniture even while she's watching TV. What a pro. Soon the group cut two albums, Meet the Brady Bunch and Merry Christmas from the Brady Bunch. Unfortunately, Paramount scooped up most of the profits from these projects, so the group decided to strike out on its own. In 1973, the Brady Bunch Kids developed an act and took it on the road.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Brady Bunch Kids!
So it was this concept of, hey, look at this great franchise we're missing out on. We'll get these kids to sing and dance, we'll take them on the road, we'll make $1 million. First we had to sing and dance. So first we had to learn how to do all of that. We were just hoofing it and trying to make a buck.
It was embarrassing because I couldn't do solos, so it was obviously absent from any of the shows we were doing. Anything in live, you know, might as well turn my mic off. It would ruin what was already up there.
With their own unique interpretation of classic rock songs like Proud Mary and Rock Around the Clock, the Brady Bunch Kids, chaperoned by their parents, toured America in the spring and summer of 1973. The group hired veteran choreographer Joe Sitar to spruce up their act.
They worked really, really hard. It was something that they really weren't used to doing.
They played at concert halls, state fairs, and theme parks right across the USA. Everywhere they went, everybody loved the Brady Kids. This success resulted in the group hiring a manager to orchestrate its affairs. And, like all managers, he promised to make them rich.
He wanted to manage everyone, he wanted to be everybody's agent, and was, you know, throwing his weight around and wanted to make a lot of promises about how, you know, I'll make you $1 million and we'll, you know, go in there and, you know, tell Sherwood what to do.
A revolt soon followed.
Maybe we needed somebody in there to look out for us. But it evolved into this situation where I think the intention was to actually take the ownership of the show away from Sherwood Schwartz.
You know, kids, their heads get filled with stuff. You know, you should be a big star, you should be doing this, you should be doing this. I'm going to make you much more money. And, you know, it's that siren song of, you know, great fortune.
Greed was threatening to destroy the very show that made the kids famous. Coming up, we meet the original Carol Brady and the original Alice. Welcome back. Somehow the Brady family home on Clinton Avenue was sealed off from the rest of the world. Back in the late 60s and early 70s, everything was going crazy. The Vietnam War was tearing America apart, students were rioting, revolution was in the air, along with marijuana, the sounds of Hendrix, Woodstock, and the Doors. Even staid old Australia was letting its hair down. These were turbulent times. Everybody was tuning in, turning on, and dropping out. Everybody except the Brady Bunch.
You never see a script in the Bradys that deals with, no one even mentions the Vietnam War, or a racial conflict, or the economy, or the oil slump, or all the big things that were happening in the world at the time.
In the tiny little universe of the Brady family, there was no Vietnam, there was no JFK, there was no moon landing, there was nothing complicated, there was nothing dramatic. The universe didn't matter. All that mattered was, you know, was their little house in their little suburb.
When the Brady Bunch premiered in America in 1969, critics had a field day, regularly blasting the sitcom for its sickly sweet storylines. But the show was one of the first on television to feature a family made up of kids from different marriages. Executive producer Sherwood Schwartz first came up with the idea after reading a story in the Los Angeles Times in 1965. According to the article, nearly one-third of all American families included one or more children from a previous marriage. The statistics amazed Schwartz, who was part of a traditional family, with Mrs. Schwartz and the four little Schwartzes.
It was an immediate show in my head. Immediate. I mean, my fear was that everybody, every writer would look at that little article and realize that a sociological phenomenon was occurring in the United States.
Schwartz was a bit of a sitcom guru. He started writing for Bob Hope in 1939. He later worked with such comedy legends as Ozzie and Harriet Nelson and Red Skelton. Schwartz hit pay dirt in 1963 when he created Gilligan's Island. But turning his blended family concept into a 30-minute sitcom was pretty tricky. John Rich, who directed Gilligan's Island, reckoned Sherwood was the man for the job.
His approach is pure. He's a wonderful innocent in that sense, because he feels this way about family values and so on, and I think it touches a nerve in the country.
A few months after reading the newspaper article, Schwartz wrote a pilot episode about the marriage of a widower with three boys and a divorcee with three girls. Schwartz titled the script Yours and Mine. All three US TV networks were interested. NBC wanted to cut the scene where the kids go along on the parents' honeymoon. CBS didn't want Mike and Carol to get married at all. And ABC wanted the show stretched from 30 minutes to 2 hours. Schwartz politely told them all where to go. Everything changed when a movie with a similar idea and name hit the big screen.
I'm glad I have 10 children.
And I'm glad I have my 8.
And I'm glad I'm careful.
People kept staring at us as they thought we were crazy.
They didn't get any argument from me.
Yours, Mine and Ours was a huge critical and box office success. And surprise, surprise, the networks had a change of heart.
The movie had done my pilot for me. So ABC called me and said, hey, okay, we'll do it your way.
ABC wanted to change the title of the sitcom from Yours and Mine, so audiences wouldn't confuse the television show with the movie. They tried The Brady Gang, The Brady Pack, and even The Brady Bundle, but finally settled on, well, you know what. Choosing a title was easy compared to what was to come. The script called for 9 principal actors, including a husband and wife, their 6 kids, and a housekeeper. Casting took an exhausting 3 months. The kids had first go. More than 1,000 boys and girls showed up for the open audition in Los Angeles in the summer of 1968. Barry Williams and Eve Plum were among the many desperates.
I remember going on what was known as a cattle call. I don't know if they still have them. They essentially had a sound stage, and they had, you know, just reams and tons of children, you know, grouped into age groups and hair color groups. You know, blondes over here, reds over here, redheads, you know, girls and boys of both hair color.
They had kept everyone out on the street, and then they would allow a certain number of people into the office, and finally you whittled your way into meeting Sherwood Schwartz.
The handful of kids who did get asked back had to audition several times, and their parents were subjected to lengthy interviews. Schwartz's only easy decision involved filling the part of the youngest daughter, Cindy. He was instantly smitten with a blonde, blue-eyed little girl in pigtails named Susan Olsen.
She said, I was on episode of Gunsmoke. I said, how did that work out? And she said, well, I was on this horse, and he got frightened by a snake. And I didn't have to go any further.
I did know that I was the first one picked because I have a mother who always, like, told me everything she knew. She always figured I was grown up enough to handle any information. And she had heard from my agent that I, like, had the part.
Swartz decided the audience would have an easier time figuring out who was who if the boys had the same color hair as their father and the girls the same as their mother. Comedy actress Joyce Bullifont was cast as the mother, Carol Brady.
I went in to read, and then they said, "You're Mrs. Brady, and we'll cast the children according to you." So I went in with the children, and they would put them next to me to see if the girls looked like me, which they did. And then I interviewed with the different men.
Play opposite Bullifont, Schwartz wanted a brown-haired actor for the part of Mike Brady. His choice was a little-known actor by the name of Gene Hackman. Douglas S. Kramer was the head of television production at Paramount, where the pilot was shot. Kramer preferred an up-and-coming leading man called Robert Reed. Reed had earned praise several years earlier for his portrayal of a young lawyer on the legal drama The Defenders.
I had tested Bob Reed for Barefoot in the Park. It was a half-hour pilot that we were shooting at that point, based on the successful movie. And I showed Sherwood Bob's test, and he said, "That's not what I'm looking for."
But Reed was exactly what Kramer was looking for, so he convinced the actor to meet with Schwartz.
Sherwood gave me the plot of it, and it sounded wonderful. He put it together with statistics of broken families and so forth. He said, "It's going to be comedic, but not, you know, it's going to be lifelike." Well, then I got the script of it, and it was one gag line to another. And I thought, this is, well, I don't think this has much of a chance, but they tell me I can either do this or Mission Impossible, do a segment. So anyway, I did this.
Reed was offered the role, and despite strong reservations, he accepted. With the lead actors in place, Swartz made his final choices for the kids. 12-year-old Maureen McCormack was cast as the pretty older daughter, Marsha. 9-year-old Eve Plum, who was called back because of her resemblance to Joyce Bullifant, was selected as the emotional middle child, Jan. And 7-year-old Susan Olsen was the innocent youngest daughter, Cindy. The boys' parts went to 14-year-old Barry Williams as the hip older son, Greg. 10-year-old Christopher Knight was cast as the scheming middle child, Peter. And freckle-faced Mike Lookingland, who was 7, played the shy youngest son, Bobby.
I got the job because my hair color was right, and I looked like I could be, you know, Robert Reed's son. And it wasn't a talent audition. It was essentially a look audition. I mean, and that's about what I had to offer back then, too, because I wasn't really much of an actor.
Casting was completed when veteran actress Monty Margetts was selected for the part of the housekeeper, Alice. But just 3 days before the pilot was to be shot, an unforeseen crisis occurred. Studio execs had been interested in auditioning a well-known Broadway actress called Florence Henderson for the role of Carol Brady. But Henderson's schedule made her unavailable until long after everyone else had read for the part.
I got a call from my agent saying they want you to come down to Paramount and meet John Rich and Doug Kramer and Sherwood Schwartz and all these people I had never heard of. And I said, "Why?" And he said, "For a new TV series." And I said, "I don't want to do a TV series. I live in New York City."
Henderson eventually changed her mind, and at the last minute, Swartz and the studio execs decided to let her audition. Everyone was so impressed that Florence was immediately offered the part, and that's why we've never heard of Joyce Bullifont.
I called her up and I said I had to talk to her about something, and she says, "Fine, come over." So I went over and we talked, and I said, "There's been a change. Florence Henderson, who was scheduled to test, wasn't available. She has come out, and she's very good."
To think that you've got the lead in a series and then you don't have it, it's tough.
That was not the last change. Henderson wasn't as funny as Bullifont, so Monty Margetts was replaced by funny lady Anne B. Davis, who Swartz felt could supply the necessary comic relief. Davis had won 2 Emmys for the role of Schultze on the popular 1950s sitcom The Bob Cummings Show.
Seems a shame to just let it go to waste after we paid the money and everything. And I could, let it go to waste.
Davis was performing at a nightclub in Seattle when she was summoned to the Brady Bunch set.
They said, you're on, Anne. We're going to buy you out of your last week in the nightclub and come down and shoot the pilot. So I didn't know all that was going on. I just knew it happened very fast and sounded pretty good to me.
With the show's first crisis resolved and casting finalized, shooting of the pilot got underway in September 1968, more than 3 years after Sherwood Schwartz first pitched his original idea. But at least one cast member bet the Brady Bunch would be short-lived.
I thought to myself, no one will ever see it again. But they can't take this. We didn't do anything worth doing. I wouldn't have given it a nickel's chance.
After the break, Mike Brady threatens to walk out on his family. If the 70s was the decade style forgot, then the Brady Bunch were the first ones to lose their memory. Even though the show kicked off in 1969, its fashion, language and spirit were definitely 70s. And for a generation of impressionable Aussie youngsters, if the Bradys did it, said it or wore it, then you did too.
Well, obviously they've had absolutely no influence on my sense of clothing and style. Not. And then, of course, there's Carol. Well, this hairdo is very much my tribute. My new hairdo, it's a tribute to Carol Brady.
I think fashion-wise, they had a great influence on me. I mean, Greg's wacky sense of fashion when he went into the hippie thing, and when they got the record contract, that was wild. Their jumpsuits was burned into my memory.
I love the way they dressed for the time. I thought they dressed fantastic. Now, I'm wearing a shirt today because I love the adventure they had at Hawaii. Greg found this bad luck, tiki thing, and they were all wearing these fantastic shirts.
Hordes of young viewers tuned in every Friday night to see what the Bradys were wearing and hear what they were saying.
They always wanted us to say groovy, and we were just completely embarrassed to say that, because even though it wasn't a thing to say, it was being made to say it was sort of, putting too fine a point on it.
I'm sorry, Alfie, but I just can't make it today. I promise I'll be there tomorrow.
With the payment?
Yes.
We accept cash, you know.
Groovy, it's a date. Bye. Hey, Marcia, do you want to come listen to my new record album with me? It's really far out.
I'm not in the mood for enjoying myself.
I didn't think that we were dressed cool. And there was actually some concern about not dressing us too timely. I don't know. That was the excuse they gave us. I said, why can't we wear tank shirts? And they said, because, this show will probably go into syndication and those won't be in style anymore.
As silly as the clothes seemed, some thought the episodes were even sillier. But in fact, many plots were taken directly from the creator's family life. Schwartz's daughter, Hope, was an especially good source of ideas.
Things would happen at school and I would come home and share the day's news, and then it would end up as a storyline, in an episode. Mike Brady would come in and say, pumpkin, and talk like that. And I remembered like 3 weeks before my dad doing that and thinking, I don't want my life out there. I mean, this is my life. And that was kind of surreal.
Schwartz's son, Lloyd, worked on the show as a producer. He often found himself defending his father.
One of the criticisms of the show was levied is, that's not real life. Well, it was my real life, and so I have a tough time with that criticism, because that's the way my parents would talk to me. We didn't have coming from different families, but we had a housekeeper and that kind of thing, and we related that same way.
Let's go, gang! Girls, Marcia, Peter, Bobby.
See that? Bobby's not limping a bit.
No, I'm sure you got a point. I'm afraid Bobby's got another kind of a sprain.
The network committed to a full season, ordering 11 more episodes of The Brady Bunch in the winter of 1969. That was good news to the cast, who had quickly grown fond of each other.
Well, the great thing about our show, and it sounds really schmarmy and sweet and cute, but it's absolutely true. We all got along really well, to the point where guest stars would come on the set, and the set was so happy and nice that they wouldn't want to leave.
We did have a good time doing it, and that was maybe the nicest part of it. It was a great environment to go to work.
The exception was Robert Reed, who had a bit of a problem doing comedy. Reed had studied at the British Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts in London and performed Shakespeare on Broadway in the 1950s and early 60s.
When I was very young and stupid, I wanted to be the world's greatest classical actor. And then a few years later, I thought, well, I'd just like to be a good classical actor. Then it all changes.
Director John Rich and co-star Ann B. Davis picked up on Reed's discomfort.
He had come from a rather wonderful series called The Defenders, with E.G. Marshall, and he was the young attorney, and they had done serious work. I think he was looking for that, and he was wrong in taking the role.
Don't you like it here anymore?
No, sir. Not as much as I used to.
Well, don't worry about it. You know, when a person isn't happy where he is, he has every right to look for a place where he can be happier. You know what beats me is how very wrong we were. We all love you. And we thought you loved us, too.
Oh, I do. It's just... well, I better be going.
I thought you'd be mad.
Why? Listen, you wouldn't want me to stay around if I didn't want to, would you?
You have to. You're the father.
That's very true.
Bob was not a happy man on that set. Because, for one thing, he didn't want to do the pilot. It was a contractual thing. He had to do the pilot. And I think he was disappointed that he sold. I mean, he had quite a classical training background. And I don't really think that working on a children's show was his idea of where he wanted to go with his career. Mm-hmm. And so that, you know, there was that tension right from the start.
In public, though, Reed made out everything was fine.
Shoot, I was doing a play in New York at the same time I was doing The Defenders. And I'd play comedy at night and drama in the daytime. First of all, I think as an actor, when you're doing something that's supposed to be funny, you can't wait to... I mean, you get off stage and you're serious. Or if you're doing something that's serious, you can't wait to give a gag line when you get off. It's an easy transition to make, I think.
But on the set of The Brady Bunch, Reed wasn't quite so easygoing. His frustration over the role of Mike Brady led to frequent open arguments with producer Sherwood Schwartz. Reed threatened to quit several times during the first season.
There were a number of times he came to my office and just said, I gotta get out of this, and how did you ever talk me into it, and I can't deal with this man, and a couple of times he threatened to hold press conferences and do things.
He was just not a happy camper on our show. I tried to get off it at least three times in the first year, and it was a constant struggle for him all the time.
Although Reed never followed through on his threats to quit, he continued to fight with Sherwood Schwartz, his son Lloyd, and anyone else in power. Reed's major gripes revolved around scripts which he thought were juvenile and full of factual errors.
He wanted better scripts. And I'd go, Bob, we're not doing Shakespeare here. Remember that. This is situation comedy with the underlying word being comedy. And sometimes he'd find that difficult. You know, I think he really wanted to be doing Shakespeare and grander things.
He once walked off the stage because the script had the wrong population for Poughkeepsie. Instead of 430,000, it was 480,000. I said, well, the writer probably used the previous, you make excuses. This is lunatic picking, you know. He's not talking about the drama. He's not talking about the comedy. He's talking about simple facts that you can look up in an encyclopedia, which he used to do.
By the end of the first season in the spring of 1970, The Brady Bunch was pulling in modest ratings, and the show's lead actor was constantly threatening to walk out. The prospects didn't look good, but things were about to change. Now, if there's one thing Americans do really well, it's make money. And that goes double for Americans in television. After all, they invented it. So when the Bradys turned the corner and started to grow in popularity, the network bigwigs realized they had a real money spinner. The only people who didn't share in the profits were the Bradys themselves. Even though their popularity zoomed, their paychecks didn't move an inch. By the third season in 1972, the Brady Bunch defied the critics by cracking the ratings top 20 and winning its Friday night time slot. But while the networks pulled in millions in advertising revenue, the people who played the Bradys were basically salary employees. To capitalize on their fame and make some money, the younger cast members formed a musical group, the Brady Bunch Kids. On stage, it was a cheerful review, but backstage, no one was singing a happy tune.
That divided our group and fractured our group almost irreparably.
As the Brady Bunch built a following in the early 1970s, episode budgets began to grow. New storylines called for location shoots in the Grand Canyon and Hawaii.
The Hawaiian episodes that we filmed, in some respects, was built around my surfing. And growing up in California, the only thing I'd been longer than a Brady was a surfer.
Celebrities were also frequent guest stars. Bobby tossed a ball with American football great Joe Namath. Greg received pitching tips from baseball star Don Drysdale. And Marcia was escorted to a senior prom by pop idol Davy Jones of the Monkees.
Cheer up, Sleepy Jean. Oh, what can it mean to a daydream believer and a homecoming queen?
First time I'd gone on a show, and I was Davy Jones. Instead of an actor, you know, playing a part, I was playing myself. So I figured, hey, I've made it, you know.
The Brady Bunch Kids musical group formed shortly after Davy Jones' appearance on the show. They made several albums that year, and in the spring of 1973, they went on tour. Everything began to unravel when the group demanded that some of their musical numbers be worked into future episodes of The Brady Bunch. They also asked for more money.
The Brady Kids were feeling their oats, and we had ideas for directions that we might go that would be in our best interests, whether or not they were in the show's best interests, or whether or not they were following Sherwood's wishes.
Executive producer Sherwood Schwartz was furious at his greedy cast and told them what they could do with their pay rise demands.
They signed certain contracts. I said, I signed a contract. When the rating goes up, I don't run to Paramount and say, hey, the rating went up, I want a raise. I said, when I sign something, I sign.
Tough negotiations with Sherwood Schwartz were too much pressure for Susan Olsen and Eve Plum. Disheartened, they left the musical group. Maureen McCormack soon followed, and by August 1973, the Brady Bunch Kids were history.
We were really starting to get popular, and I think that it could have gone other places if we hadn't had this breakup, this division.
That's the kind of stuff that you usually see immediately in a show, you know, the politics. And it took 5 years for that to develop in our show, but it did happen.
A divided cast returned for the fifth season of The Brady Bunch in the autumn of 1973. The atmosphere became more stressful during the filming of the first episode, shot at an amusement park in Ohio. Eager fans overwhelmed the Bradys at both the park and their hotel.
They had no security, and so we had people like looking in our rooms, following us to our rooms, hanging out in the lobby. I don't know, I'm a very private person. That's really a lousy feeling.
Tensions continued to linger after the amusement park fiasco. While the rest of the country was being torn apart by social changes and the Vietnam War, the Bradys lived in a time warp. The actors grew increasingly frustrated with what they considered outdated dialogue and storylines.
I resented the fact that we didn't get into trouble on the show, and, you know, I thought it too was bland and milquetoast and, you know, non-representative of a child's life back then.
I became more aware that Cindy was supposed to be very adorable and very cute when I started to grow up, and I was very aware that I wasn't as adorable and I wasn't as cute, and I was getting more and more and more awkward. And the scripts weren't really changing.
I sometimes felt very frustrated that we were, you know, couldn't act more normal as parents, you know, raise our voices and show the frustration and the, you know, all that you go through, the angst as a parent. It was all very kind of glossed over.
Creator Sherwood Schwartz still hoped the Brady Bunch would be renewed for a sixth season.
Bob and Sherwood were both like two little umpires on a little league team, and they were both absolutely convinced they were right. It was just a series of knockdown, drag-out fights.
The duo saved their biggest battle for last. They argued during rehearsals for the final show of the fifth series. Reed thought the script about Bobby selling miracle hair tonic was so stupid, they refused to say his lines. Schwartz responded by writing him out of the episode, but an angry Reed refused to leave the set.
He won't go to his dressing room, he insists on staying on the stage. And so Paramount said to me, we will send two guards down and carry him off the stage if that's the only way to get him off the stage. I said, no way, not in front of those kids. I don't want to see Mr. father, Mr. Brady, carted off the set by two uniformed policemen.
The interesting thing about that is that Bob would not leave. He would sit in the background and watch.
He's a very complex man.
Reed eventually left the set on his own and did not appear in the episode. Infuriated, Schwartz told studio executives that he was fed up with Reed's antics and suggested the character of Mike Brady either be killed off or recast if the show was picked up for a sixth season. The constant bickering, coupled with declining ratings, were more than enough for the network.
Pretty much out of the blue, on a, I think it was a Wednesday or Thursday afternoon, I got a call from a gentleman at the network, and he called and said that it was his unpleasant job. Well, first he said, I'm sitting here, Barry, with now a half-gone bottle of bourbon. And I said, well, sounds like you're having a heck of an afternoon. And he said, yeah, but not so pleasant. I've been given the task of informing the cast that the series has been canceled and there will be there'll be no more new shows.
And I don't want to hear another word about it.
The Brady Bunch was cancelled in May of 1974. The sitcom's demise was a mixed blessing for the cast.
I could have done it for another few years. I wouldn't have minded at all. I enjoyed that. I liked the people. I liked the people on camera. I liked the people off camera. I would have enjoyed doing it for quite a while.
I had bought in a little bit and gotten used to some of the adulation, so saying goodbye, that wasn't going to be something easy to do. But nonetheless, I had another impulse to, you know, just want to just throw it all away.
By the last year, I was ready to go. I think I was, you know, 15. It'd been 5 years, you know. I may have been ready to go anyway.
Oh, I've had it with this show. I'll call you back, Kay. Bye. Maybe I can find a rerun of a rerun I haven't seen.
When we come back, the Brady Bunch's embarrassing return to television. Excited about the cancellation than Robert Reed, who finally had the opportunity to go after the serious roles he'd always wanted. In 1975, the 43-year-old actor earned his first Emmy nomination for his portrayal of a father and husband who became a transsexual in the drama Medical Center. He added a second nomination later that year for his performance as decadent millionaire Teddy Boyland in the popular miniseries Rich Man, Poor Man. Reed's obsession with shedding his Brady Bunch image didn't carry over to co-star Florence Henderson. In fact, she embraced her motherly persona and in 1975 began a 25-year run as the spokeswoman for cooking oil.
The chicken's got a certain personality.
Anne B. Davis had no worries about being typecast either. She'd already worked in television for over 20 years. But when the Brady Bunch went off air, the 50-year-old performer found few acting roles she liked. Davis became so disillusioned that she decided to make a complete change.
You know, a whole bunch of years there, I'd lived in Los Angeles, I'd worked in the business, I knew what it was like. I'd had playtime, I'd gone to premieres and, you know, all this kind of stuff that one gets caught up in. And it wasn't all that much fun, frankly. And so that when this new life began to happen for me, I was just delighted.
In 1976, Davis sold her house and moved to Denver to be part of a religious commune. She spent her time studying the Bible, working in the community, and acting as a volunteer in a homeless shelter.
I went down twice a week just to do the laundry. I mean, people would come in off the street and we had showers for them. And we'd take their dirty clothes and give them clean clothes and then wash their dirty clothes and give them to somebody else.
While Davis found peace in her post-Brady Bunch days, her younger co-stars weren't having as much luck. In fact, the Brady kids were given a very chilly reception by Hollywood.
Producers and casting directors did not want to hire somebody with my previous image, and I couldn't help but kind of understand that. However, I was very frustrated with the fact that I had this mold on me that I didn't think was fair.
Olsen decided to wait it out and renew her acting career after the Brady Bunch had become a distant memory. The wait would be a long one. At first, the cancellation of the Brady Bunch came as a relief for cast members who were tired of their goody-two-shoes characters. But while some found other acting jobs right away, most had trouble shedding their Brady image. The transition wouldn't get any easier as new generations of kids fell in love with the series.
I think at that time they figured 5 years, that was a long run.
Little did they know we'd be coming back.
The Brady Bunch was never a favourite of the critics, and the sitcom was seen as a joke within the entertainment industry. Christopher Knight and Susan Olsen experienced the ridicule firsthand.
Being a former Brady and trying to do anything in the industry was extremely uncool. And there was not really any respect for us. It's like, oh yeah, you were on that stupid Saccharine Sweet show. And it's like, well, I didn't write the scripts.
If you're not respected and you're a Brady, you become a real easy mark. You got a target the size of Nebraska on your back.
The backlash was also humbling for 19-year-old Barry Williams. The role of Greg Brady had made him one of the biggest teen idols of the early 1970s. And he thought the whole world wanted his services.
I had attitude about it. Somebody very innocently might say, gee, Barry Williams might be right for this role in this movie. We'd like him to come in and audition or come in and interview or read. And I might come back with, hey, if you want to see what I do, turn on the TV.
That attitude, needless to say, went down really well with Hollywood casting directors.
All the time that I joined, started in the business from the time I was about 10 until 20, it had all been one straight rise. So why then at 20 should it take a nosedive? And when it did, it is extremely humbling and it is extremely difficult to adjust to.
Eve Plum was the only Brady who was able to shake the typecasting problems which plagued her co-stars. Months after her high school graduation in 1976, Plum scored a plum role in a controversial television movie.
I think every actor wants to play somebody who's bad, you know, somebody who's doing the bad thing. So I got to play a teen prostitute, and of course I was so naive.
You won't forget me. You'll come for me.
Anytime you need me.
But I need you now.
Plum received glowing reviews for her portrayal of Dawn, but similar roles dried up as The Brady Bunch became a hit in syndication. By 1976, the sitcom aired every afternoon on television stations across the country, as well as abroad, as we all know.
Probably one of the reasons it appeals so broadly to kids, I guess, is with six kids in the family, there is probably a Brady child that every child identified with. If you kind of wanted to be the pretty girl in high school, you could aspire to be Marcia Brady. If you were the middle sibling who kind of got overlooked, you probably sympathised with Jan Brady. You know, there were little girls like Cindy Brady. You know, the boys were exactly the same.
Even though millions of kids identified with the Bradys, it didn't translate into millions of dollars for them. The actors received a pittance when the Brady Bunch began its highly successful syndication run.
As I look back, they got us for so little. And then the residual contracts were not very good. So Paramount Studios has made so much money off of that show.
Frustrated at the situation, Florence Henderson, Maureen McCormack, Susan Olsen, and Mike Luckenland decided if they couldn't cash in on the Brady show, they would cash in on the Brady name. So, in the spring of 1976, they resurrected their Brady Bunch characters during a guest appearance on the popular Don and Marie show.
Why do you have time for a cold drink?
What do you have?
I have an assortment. Oh, okay. Any kind of milk you want. Any kind.
I don't want any milk.
Me neither.
It's funny because as uncool as I thought that would be, or as uncool as I knew it would be, I really, really wanted to do the show because I wanted to work with these people again. I wanted to work.
Yes, Greg left us and moved to Milwaukee.
He's gone to college?
No, he's trying to get a date with Laverne and Shirley.
We've been trying to find a teenage boy to replace him.
And we had to have someone wholesome enough to fit our image.
That episode of the Donnie and Marie show rated through the roof, prompting the phone call from then ABC Network Supremo Michael Eisner to show producer Marty Croft.
He called me up one day and he said, hey, he said, how would you guys like to leave the Donnie and Marie show and do something really special? And I said, well, what's that? He said, well, how would you like to do a variety hour with the Brady Bunch?
Michael Eisner isn't the kind of guy you say no to. So in the summer of 1976, Croft went to work on the Brady Bunch Variety Hour. Putting the cast back together was his first hurdle.
He promised me everything but the moon. I was the one with the talent. I was the one they were going to feature. It was Florence and me the whole way. And I was going to have a solo song every week, and the skits were going to be around me, and I'd have the best costumes and the biggest dressing room and the most money.
I remember that negotiation. It's like, I don't sing. Well, we want you to come back down the list. You'll just do the wraparounds and the front and the end. And you only have to do two numbers in the group, at the front and the back. And we'll just have you doing a lot of the skits and the comedy stuff.
Croft was a persuasive bloke. 8 of the original cast members signed up, including Robert Reed, a big surprise because of his intense hatred for his Brady Bunch role. Reed was excited about the opportunity to sing and dance. Eve Plum was the lone party pooper.
I'm not really sure why the decision was made to say no, other than I remember it was a very emphatic no thank you, and we're doing other things now, and it really doesn't, you know, because everybody always wants it, you know, come on, do one for the team, you know, it'll be fun, let's get everybody back together, and, you know, why, you know, be a team, and that doesn't seem to be the argument that's going to get me there.
Unable to sign Plum, Croft improvised by replacing her with a lookalike named Jerry Reichel. Reichel, who's referred to by fans as Fake Jan, joined the cast for rehearsals in the fall of 1976. The Brady Bunch Variety Hour featured a mixture of musical numbers and comedy sketches, new territory for everyone, except Florence Henderson, who started her career as a singer on Broadway.
It was very tough. They had never done this. We were trying to, you know, show them in their best light, so it was a lot of hard work to make the show happen.
For weeks, the cast worked 16-hour days in preparation for the show's premiere on Sunday, November 28, 1976. They needed to.
Lady face, I'm up in heaven when I'm in your fond embrace. I didn't need a show, 'cause I just fell in love with your pretty baby. You've got the cutest little baby face. You've got the cutest little...
I loved variety television, but it was, usually you have very trained variety performers, and the kids weren't. Barry was on his way then.
You've got the cutest little baby face. You've got...
Greg, not yet.
Music is my life.
Even Bob wasn't very musical. He wanted to be musical more than anything, and he had 2 left feet.
Look, what I really am is an architect. And my family wanted this variety show. You know, it was their idea. I didn't want to do it. But, I love my family.
Robert Reed worked the hardest, you know. He had trouble dancing, walking in rhythm, so he had trouble dancing in rhythm. But Robert Reed worked harder than anybody.
It's going to be okay, honey. Just follow me and hurry.
The complete lack of musical talent didn't seem to bother viewers, who were anxious to see how the Brady kids had grown up. The Variety Hour was the evening's highest rating television show. Croft was immediately ordered to turn it into a weekly series. The show was retitled The Brady Bunch Hour and returned to the air 2 months later in January 1977. Guest stars included such big names as Tina Turner, Charo, and supercouple Farrah Fawcett and Lee Majors.
Mr. McBride, I'd like you to meet Mr. and Mrs. Majors.
Oh.
As the world knows, he is the $6 million man, and she is, of course, one of Charlie's angels.
Yes, Mr. Merrill, we have seen them.
The Bradys are on TV, too, and they're only on once a month, but, well, they're decent people.
But audiences were less interested in the Brady Bunch Hour the second time around. I wonder why. It sank in the ratings after the first airing.
I don't think it flew because I don't think there was a public there willing to embrace the Bradys as performers and singers. And as we've talked about, there were varying degrees of ability here.
It was a little embarrassing. I was never a fan of disco music, and here we were doing all these disco songs and such, and I didn't think it was a great show, but I was really eager to do it because I like to work.
It luckily didn't last for me too long, or I would have probably killed myself.
It's not working, and I'm very, very sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
No, it isn't. You see, you don't want to do it, and I don't want to see it.
In May of 1977, after 8 shows, the plug was pulled on the Brady Bunch Hour. It was a mercy killing and a great relief to the cast, who were hugely embarrassed by the show. And it was extremely good news for Sherwood Schwartz, who had opposed the variety hour from the start.
It didn't make any sense for this nice family that has family problems suddenly doing variety. It didn't make any sense. I thought it was ridiculous. It was just ridiculous.
Despite being left out of the creation and production of the Variety Hour, Schwartz didn't let the show's failure sour his feelings about the Brady Bunch. The sitcom was thriving in syndication and remained dear to his heart and wallet. Schwartz vowed to bring America's favourite family back to television again, this time on his terms. After the break, Carol Brady goes into therapy and later the sordid mother and son secret. The Brady curse was taking effect. Acting work for anyone involved in the show was becoming harder and harder to find. For Brady's, it seemed you could run, but you couldn't hide. And while we're talking cliches, here's another. If you can't beat 'em, join 'em. Maybe the only way to be a successful ex-Brady was to embrace Bradydom.
Me too. I'm really looking forward to Saturday night, Doug. I hate to say goodbye too. Goodbye.
Pretty blonde Maureen McCormack was one of the most popular Bradys. Her role as Marcia was a hit with the girls who wanted to look like her and boys who wanted to go out with her. But McCormack, like many of her co-stars, had trouble making a living from her fame. In the late 70s, she appeared in a string of low-rent movies such as Skate Town USA and Moonshine Country Express. To break out of the Marcia Brady role, 24-year-old McCormack took on the role of a cocktail waitress in the 1981 low-budget movie Texas Lightning.
You better get out of here.
Why, I ain't done nothing. Will you kiss me?
Not surprisingly, the movie did little to further her acting career. In need of work, she agreed to reprise her role as Marcia Brady in the television movie, The Brady Girls Get Married. The project was the brainchild of, guess who? Sherwood Schwartz, who for years had wanted a cast reunion. In 1981, Schwartz got the chance. The story featured the dual wedding ceremonies of sisters Marcia and Jan, but there was a condition. The telemovie could only go ahead if Schwartz brought back the original cast, including Robert Reed. But this wasn't easy, since Schwartz and Reed fought like pit bulls throughout the Brady Bunch. Amazingly, Reed agreed to have a go.
I think I can say that we're as close as any cast could be. First of all, we were playing a family at the time when the kids were kids, and we spent 5 years at it, watched them grow. We spent more time together than we did with our own families, and we liked each other.
Even Eve Plum, who had wisely shunned the Brady Bunch Variety Hour, agreed to appear in the movie.
They managed to come up with some money. And you know, it's like you say no and they keep adding money. And it's not like it's $1 million, billion, but at the time, when you're not doing anything and somebody calls up and says, would you do this for this money? You know? it gets hard to say no.
The Brady Girls Get Married was a ratings winner, and the network immediately ordered a spin-off series called The Brady Brides. The half-hour sitcom featured Marcia, Jan, and the new husbands all sharing a house, with Florence Henderson resuscitating her role as the mother, Carol. The show premiered in February of 1981. Jerry Hauser played Marcia's husband, Wally.
So the premise of The Brady Brides was that they neither could afford a house because it's too expensive, so the two couples move in together. Marcia and Wally are kind of wild and free and fun and sleep in the nude, and Jan and Philip are kind of uptight and straight, and the wild, wacky problems that happen from there.
At respectable ratings and reviews, the series was not renewed after completing its original run in April of 1981. The end of The Brady Brides marked the beginning of a difficult period for the family's matriarch, Florence Henderson. In 1984, Henderson filed for divorce from her husband, Ira Bernstein, after 28 years of marriage. The couple had four children.
I don't like to not feel good in life or be happy. And I had reached a point in my life where I wasn't.
It was during this time that the usually unflappable actress had to stop performing after developing a fear of being on stage. To deal with her problem, the 51-year-old Henderson underwent hypnosis at a Los Angeles clinic.
What I'm going to do is ask you to open your eyes, and I want you to look directly at me. Now. Okay, that's fine.
The unorthodox treatment worked. In 1985, a rejuvenated and reconstructed Henderson returned to work as hostess of her own television show, Country Kitchen.
When Bob and I did the Brady Bunch for 4 or 5 years, not to mention all the variety hours we did and the Brady Brides getting married, one time, do you remember when we switched roles? Your job was a lot easier, I thought, than mine.
While Henderson got her act together, yet another generation of youngsters was introduced to the Brady Bunch. The show's continued success convinced creator Sherwood Schwartz the world was ready for a new Brady venture. Sherwood's plan was brilliant. The Bradys plus Christmas. It couldn't miss.
First of all, you have not only the Brady Bunch, which everybody loves, you have Christmas. You can't discount Christmas. So you put those two elements together and you have yourself a very big rating.
So once again, the cast reassembled at the Paramount lot.
Coming back to spend this month doing 2 hours of a Brady Christmas was a little like a family reunion in a family that cares deeply for each other. And I know it sounds sappy. It is sappy, I suppose. But when we did the scene with the Christmas tree and the singing of the carols, there weren't a dry eye among us.
A very Brady Christmas gave everyone involved an early present. The show was the highest-rated network program of the week and the most watched television movie of the year.
I think we were all stunned by that, truly. And again, it just amazed me that people out there just loved the show.
What it told me was that we had had an impact. We have had an impact in this country.
Hoping for future Brady miracles, CBS signed for 3 more movies. In January of 1990, weeks before the first of the movies was to air, network executives had a bright idea. The project would serve as a pilot for a new series.
With all apologies to those that created the show, I had a feeling that this format would not work.
The format was a 1-hour drama called The Bradys, intended to be a grown-up version of the original series.
Here's the story of the family Brady. A mom and dad with all their children grown. Our kids are now pursuing their dream with families of their own. When our kids were small, their problems all were smaller. As they changed, so did their point of view. The world has taken on a larger meaning. Since the family grew.
I referred to it in those days as Brady something, like 30 something.
The Brady something format didn't appeal to Maureen McCormack, so she opted out. Wise girl. Most of the cast who came back didn't like the format either. Eve Plum, Susan Olsen, and Leah Ayres Kalish, the fake Maureen, all openly made fun of the show.
Yeah, the show is really expanding. This hour-long format has allowed us to...
When do we do the one where we all go up to a commune and
the
drop commune, acid?
Drop acid, I think, is the 7th episode.
Right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
The Bradys premiered on February 9, 1990.
We started off getting bad reviews again, and I'd forgotten, because by that time I was used to being loved by great handfuls of people at a time who had loved the show for years and years. And so when we started getting bad reviews again, I was really taken aback at first. Then I remembered, aha, we never got good reviews.
The negative reviews hurt the series. Tensions on the set were particularly high, especially between old rivals Sherwood Schwartz and Robert Reed.
There'd be many days that Bob would be upset about the scripts or upset about the way certain things were going. And he was known to depart from the set once in a while during the middle of shooting.
Bob was even more cantankerous than usual. He just had so much angst and so much going on.
I don't think he was that well at the time. And I know that he needed to really conserve his energy, and he would pretty much disappear when we weren't working.
In fact, Reed was a sick man and was doing his best to conceal his deteriorating health from everyone, including his daughter Karen. Worried co-star and close friends like actress Anne Haney knew there was a problem.
You sort of suspect. You think there's something awry here. It's something bad.
Up next, the final days of television's favorite father. The third decade of Bradydom for the actors, and basically they were fed up with it. Even the lure of cash was losing its appeal, and for Robert Reed there were far more serious problems to try and overcome. In March of 1990, The Bradys was cancelled. A year later, in the spring of 1991, 58-year-old Reed tested positive for HIV. His health quickly deteriorated. Reed's condition was further complicated by the onset of a form of cancer known as colon lymphoma. Close friend, actress Anne Haney, accompanied her friend to the doctor.
He had decided he could beat them both, but he had to take the battles one at a time. So he decided to beat the cancer, and he and his doctors agreed to a very aggressive treatment.
By the end of November 1991, Reed was undergoing very extensive chemotherapy treatments. Too weak to work, he spent most of his time alone at his elegant Pasadena home.
You always respected Bob's privacy. And I would call him, and we'd make a date, and then he'd call me and say, I really don't feel up to it today. And I knew that he probably didn't want me to see him, not as at his best.
Sadly, Reed's condition did not improve. No longer able to care for himself, he checked into a Pasadena hospital on May 1, 1992.
It wasn't until he went into the hospital that he really then gave up, you know. Not gave up, but he sort of recognized that this is what it was going to have to be. And then his physical presence changed.
Frail and barely able to speak, Reed broke the news to his television family for the first time.
I got a call from him saying, Florence, I didn't really lie to you. He said, I really thought I would, but he said, I'm not going to make it. And I kind of gulped, and I said, I need to ask you for another favor. And, this is always hard. So he asked me to call all the kids and tell them. And so I did. And it was really tough for all of them.
So when Florence called and said that he was ill, I was pretty sure what it was. And yet still I was like, I was busy composing a letter to him because I knew Bob was really, really private. And I thought that he probably wouldn't want visitors unless he requested visitors. And also, I think I was really scared.
Susan never had a chance to mail her letter. On May 12, 1992, just days after the phone call, Reed passed away from complications of AIDS. He was only 59.
He was just somebody that I'd worked with very closely and looked up to. So it's very hard. He was also just so wonderfully sweet and such a great role model and such a great teacher. That it was very, very difficult. Very sad. And it'll continue to be.
I'd known him worked with him for 20-odd years. Of course I was sad. It's too young to go.
Shortly after Reed's death, several tabloid newspapers ran articles revealing his homosexual lifestyle and HIV-positive status. Details the intensely private Reed never discussed with anyone other than a few close friends.
It was not the way he would like to have been remembered. He would prefer to have been remembered for his body of work rather than his personal life, but he also knew that would never happen, of course.
Sherwood Schwartz, who cast Reed in the role of Mike Brady in 1968 and then lived to regret the decision, chose not to attend the memorial service.
I had some concern when Bob Reed died of AIDS. I thought that would hurt the syndication. It didn't matter at all. Nobody cared. They loved him as Mr. Brady, and that was the end of it.
Reed gave one of his last interviews to his television son, Barry Williams. In the late 1980s, Williams decided to write a book about his experiences as Greg Brady. Growing Up Brady was released in 1991, shortly before Reed's death. The book included extensive passages which detailed Reed's bitter battles with Sherwood Schwartz and his son Lloyd.
He was trying to control the family. And if he's controlling the family, and he is the head of this family, then I have no place in the family, and Dad has no place in the family, and he has to get rid of us, which he kept trying to do.
Williams' book gave America its first glimpse into the intimate details of one of television's most beloved families. But Williams saved the juiciest gossip for himself.
I had an infatuation with Florence the whole time we were filming the show, and there was always some innocent flirtation going back and forth. Most importantly, she didn't treat me like a kid, and I really respected that. She has a great sense of humor, and I was very responsive to that.
In a now notorious chapter titled Dating Your Mom, Williams recalled how his infatuation with 36-year-old Florence Henderson eventually led to a date. In 1970, when Barry was 15, the two took in dinner and a show at the famous Coconut Grove Club in Los Angeles.
The date that we went on, I think, had more expectations in my teenage and juvenile fantasy than it ever took on for her. Nonetheless, she was very kind.
I think he wanted to sell a lot of books, and he did, you know, and that was okay. I mean, if you read the book, you see how innocent our date was, but people would just love to think that, you know, there was incest on the Brady Bunch. They'd love that.
The revelations in Growing Up Brady generated a ton of press and fueled even greater interest in the television family. In 1992, the play, The Real Life Brady Bunch, recreated episodes of the original show. The amateur production drew standing room only crowds in Chicago, New York, and Los Angeles.
I'll never forget that football game as long as I live. Hey, you guys. Out of my nose!
The success of The Real Life Brady Bunch caught the play's producers, Faith and Jill Soloway, by surprise.
We just prayed that we'd get an audience, you know. And after that first week, we never made a flyer or did any kind of advertisement at all. Just word of mouth sent people down in droves to the theater to see it.
The reason the show was so popular was that it showed the gap, the distance between what was shown on television in the 70s and what you saw now in the 90s with real live actors live on stage in front of you. We didn't change any of the dialogue at all, nothing at all. We tried to make it as strictly adherent to the feel of the television show as we possibly could and let the audience bring their own colouring pencils to it and understand the differences between then and today.
Up next, a new look Brady Bunch hits the big screen. So the Bradys had done sitcoms, animation, telemovies, variety, drama, and theatre. Well, there was only one place left to go, the big screen. Trying to find yet another way to bring the Bradys to the people, Sherwood Schwartz came up with the notion of the Brady feature film. And how to solve the small problem of not having the original cast? Easy. Get a whole new cast. With interest in the Brady Bunch at an all-time high, Sherwood and Lloyd Schwartz convinced Paramount to bring the Bradys to the big screen, complete with a new cast and an added twist.
A feature film has to be in some way majestic and different than the TV show. We knew about the success, and we had seen the success of the real-life Brady Bunch and the satirical ability to do that, and I'd even seen it on Saturday Night Live.
A satirical look at the Brady family was exactly what Paramount wanted. With a relatively small $12 million budget, the Brady Bunch movie began shooting in 1994. Shelley Long signed on to play Carol Brady.
I knew about the show, but I didn't know the show. So I had to really learn her character, her movements, her voice. This was a parody. This was Carol in the 90s. So this was a little bit different Carol once she's dealing with more 90s things.
Dittmeyer.
Mr. Dittmeyer says seats overhung, but he's not in a good mood because he's taking it in the rear.
Must be that paper boy again.
Cindy, that's Mr. Dittmeyer's business.
One of the big strengths of the Brady Bunch feature films is that as satire, they were done very well, and they were certainly done very lovingly. Clearly, you know, obviously the involvement of Sherwood Schwartz in the films meant that while they really set out to lampoon what the Brady Bunch was about, they certainly didn't denigrate it, they didn't put it down. In fact, they kind of embraced it quite sweetly and really kind of ran with it.
Kids, I'm afraid the money that we were counting on is no longer a possibility. But I want you to remember that no matter where we go, or whatever house we're in, we'll be fine as long as we're together. So I don't want to see any more frowns. We're Brady's. And as a wise man once said, wherever you go, there you are.
Never thought of it that way, man.
The movie ranked number one at the box office in its first 2 weeks of release in February 1995. It went on to take more than $50 million in the US alone, four times what it cost to make. The success of the Brady Bunch movie paved the way for a sequel. In 1997, the big screen release of A Very Brady sequel followed the Brady family through yet another modern day adventure.
They say, at least now the Brady Bunch is over. And I say, you know, the Brady Bunch is a lot of things, but over it isn't. Brady Bunch has left the land of television. Brady Bunch has entered the land of Americana.
Books, plays, and movies have not diminished interest in the original sitcom. With Brady Mania entering its fourth decade, the sitcom's creator and cast ponder how long the ride will last.
Years ago, people would say to me, what show is going to replace the Brady Bunch? And then I finally figured it out, and it's the Brady Bunch.
The continued popularity of the Brady Bunch still keeps the show's cast in the spotlight. Mike Lookingland was only 7 years old when he was offered the role of Bobby Brady. Although Lookingland gave up on acting almost 10 years ago, he made national news in 1997 following a drink driving arrest. Lookingland, who now works as a television cameraman, hasn't given an interview since the incident.
They don't want to necessarily be tied into Brady's their whole lives, and I can understand it. I have not had to live my life being recognized as a Brady and being celebrated for something I did 30 years ago.
Maureen McCormack also shies away from discussions about the Brady Bunch and declines most interview requests on the subject. The married mother of a young daughter still enjoys acting, and in 1998 earned favourable reviews for her portrayal of country singer Barbara Mandrell in a television movie. Get to the heart of the Barbara Mandrell story.
A band, a microphone, the Jordanaires. What else does a girl need?
Eve Plum has appeared in numerous television shows and movies since her Brady Bunch days. But dealing with her ongoing fame as Jan Brady has been a difficult challenge.
As far as regretting it, no. Sometimes I wish it would go away, yes. You know? Some, you know, wish that the people just see me as I am and, you know, forget about that. But they can't necessarily. They might be asking too much.
After the break, Peter makes it big in Silicon Valley. We all know Mike is no longer available. Jan would like everyone to forget the show. Marcia refuses to talk about it. And Bobby was charged with drink driving. But what about the rest of them? As Peter Luck used to say, where are they now? Christopher Knight struggled with his Peter Brady persona for years. In the early 1990s, Knight gave up acting and focused on his interest in computers. Today, he is a partner in a high-tech company in Silicon Valley. One of his first projects was a CD-ROM game based on, you guessed it, the Brady Bunch.
There was some pain on the Brady thing, but there seems to be value in it on this side in that I have a choice. The door might open for me, the ice might be broken a little bit easier for me.
Being known as Greg Brady never bothered Barry Williams. He escaped the typecasting problems that plagued his co-stars by concentrating on a singing career. He has performed in nightclubs across the country, and appeared in several Broadway musicals, including The Music Man and Victor Victoria.
In theater, you go up, you sing your song, you read your scene, you take a look, and you know, you're either right for the role or you're not. And I find that television is so personality-driven, so perception-driven, and so incestuous that sometimes you're fighting elements that you can't possibly compete.
Susan Olsen had the toughest time escaping her character, the pigtailed and lisping Cindy Brady. Olsen had surgery to lose her lisp, changed her hairstyle, and even sang in a rock band. Over time, however, she learned to value the show and her sibling co-stars.
I think that there's always going to be something that binds us together, and the fact that, you know, no matter how old we live to be, there will only be five other people on the face of the planet that will ever know what the experience was really like.
Although she doesn't like to cook, Anne B. Davis cashed in on her image as the perfect housekeeper by co-authoring Alice's Brady Bunch cookbook in 1994. In 1998, Davis retired to San Antonio in Texas, where she remains committed to her life of religion.
I really don't care to perform on stage or off anymore. I've really done that. I'm very happy and content with my life, the people that I share my life with, and the place that I've come to live. And I'd just rather not do that anymore. And if God is good, he'll let me retire.
No one has embraced the success of the Brady Bunch more than Florence Henderson. The eternally youthful Henderson has turned her role as America's best-known mum into a steady stream of work in television, movies, and on stage. In 1996, she was honoured for her achievements with a star on Hollywood's Walk of Fame. Henderson never tires of talking about the show that made her a star.
I think this show represents something that everyone longs for in life. Whether you're gay, straight, whatever you are, parents long for that kind of relationship with their kids, kids long for it with their parents. It's really a gentle, sweet show, but I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think we obviously need something like that in our lives, and I think that's why that little show doesn't go away.
Even Robert Reed ultimately came to accept the value of his role in the Brady Bunch.
Generation after generation that comes along can still identify with these kids with the same problems. Yes, it's not as complex as real life, but it's not meant to be.
Creator Sherwood Schwartz, who recently celebrated his 50th winning anniversary, refuses to slow down. He and his son Lloyd are currently working on several projects involving the Bradys. Schwartz says he's only giving the people what they want.
I get fan mail that is unbelievable. I mean, people love me. I hate to put it that way, but they do. They love me, not because of me. They love me because what I have given them.
There's not a lot of television and there's not a lot of multimedia that actually teaches you anything. And I think that maybe you walk away from the Brady Bunch feeling this nice or this fuzzy. I don't know a lot of other shows that can boast that.
I think the Brady Bunch were so influential in the sense that I don't think any families since the series have actually ever fought or let the sun go down on their anger, as Mike Brady used to say, very eloquently, I thought. And in fact, I'm sure all families now, as a result of the Brady Bunch, they have a problem, it's talked through, and all resolved and fixed up within the space of a half hour. In fact, 19 commercial minutes.
I think the reason that the Bradys have gone on and on and on is, and they probably will continue to, is because there's something underlyingly sweet about the show that we kind of respond to at the very same time that we feel a slight kind of contempt for them for being so incredibly daggy. And we know we're somewhere in the middle of all of that.
The Brady Bunch, interestingly enough, has influenced my career a lot because I've been lucky enough to interview both the actor Christopher Knight, who played Peter Brady, and Florence Henderson, of course, who played Mrs. Brady.
This is the last Brady, my last Brady child. Oh, I'm so glad I found you, Angela.
See you later.
I'll be back soon,
okay,
I promise.
Okay.
Yes, Mom.
That's the way they became the Brady Bunch.
Woo! The Brady Bunch.
Coming up next, a real treat for all Brady fans. The very first episode of the show that started it all.
The Brady Bunch.
So there you are, everything you ever wanted to know about the Brady Bunch, and quite a bit you didn't. The funny thing is, you get the feeling that despite everything, they really all do like each other. And if I know Sheryl Schwartz, and after all that I think I do, then I reckon we haven't seen the last of the Brady Bunch. Not by a long shot. Stay tuned for the next installment. I'm Melissa Jane Cook, and this was as close to being Cindy as I'll ever get. Good night.
And I'd like to thank you in front of the whole world for giving me such a wonderful family.
Singing and dancing isn't everything.
Singing and dancing is my life.
Say goodnight, Greg.
Good night.
Memories light the corners of our minds. Misty watercolored memories of the way we were.
Good night, everyone.
Mind30 Tuesday, Dylan has been gone for 3 years. Now the original bad boy of Beverly Hills is back and in good company. On Tuesday nights, an all-new season of Beverly Hills 90210. Mind30 Tuesday on 10. Coming up next, 10 News.